Okay, then let's go. Good morning and welcome to Statistical Methods. And today's topic is multiple linear regression. Again, like last week, let's do all questions from 4 on. So if there are questions regarding older sessions or sessions before today's session, let's postpone them until 4 p.m. and also for exam questions if there are any. So the topic today is multiple linear regression, and before we start that, I think one thing that is still open is to briefly discuss simple linear regression again, although we've seen simple linear regression also in the course, also in its GLM formulation already, but let's start with this nevertheless. And then let's go to multiple linear regression proper and discuss its GLM viewpoint and perspective. Then we should discuss if we have a multiple linear regression design with different regressors, some properties of these regressors, and these are these notions of linearly independent, orthogonal, and uncorrelated regressors, which are all terms that float around. And what I want to do with this is to give you a precise definition of these different terms. And then let's have a look at a measure of statistical efficiency for multiple linear regression. And this would then basically conclude the theory aspects or theoretical aspects of regression designs. And as a last bit, I then want to discuss the application of multiple linear regression in fMRI analysis, because that's where in cognitive neuroscience you will find GLMs more often, most often, and this is then nothing but multiple linear regression, but it has a certain logic that needs some getting used to, and that's what I want to discuss then as the last bit of today's statistical methods. And it also links in nicely, I think, with what you're currently doing in neurocognitive methods. So in a way to get warm and to get started with statistical methods today, let's start with simple linear regression again. And again, we've seen simple linear regression previously. It was one of the motivating examples, and we also looked at it when we did beta estimation. I'm not quite sure. At one point we looked at it. And also to get warm again with the entire logic. So what we've been discussing are specific cases of the GLM. And as we introduced last time, with specific cases, we always mean specific design matrices and associated beta parameter vectors. So the design matrix essentially determining how many beta parameters there are, because if you have p columns, then there must be p beta parameter vectors. And in depending on what these design matrix columns encode, the beta parameters might also assume different meanings. And we've seen that last time for a very simple design matrix, just with a column of ones, then the beta parameter corresponds to the population mean or the population parameter. And what we will primarily look at today is, of course, the beta parameter estimators that one can still kind of have informative looks at for most designs. Of course, in general, it's just this equation for the estimation, but it might still be informative to look at the specific form. What we will, might also still look at, but not make that much of a deal about today, are variance estimators and t-statistics, because they can always be applied, specifically t-statistics, once we define a certain contrast vector. So they will not feature that much today. That's maybe why I'm putting them in brackets here today. And the main aim of this entire thing, or a big focus, is of course just to get to know the different design matrices that represent the different statistical methods from the perspective of the GLM. So that's the overall state that we are considering, or the overall topic, the overall content. And let's then jump right into simple linear regression. So like for the t-test and for any GLM, we can give these two kinds of perspectives on the different designs. So one thing is to talk about the distributions of single data random variables in this design, and in simple linear regression, each individual data point is assumed to have an expectation that is given in terms of this expression here. It depends on a specific value of the independent variable, which, as we will see, corresponds to a specific value in one of the rows of the design matrix, multiplied by a scalar B, and added to this whole thing another scalar A. And that's the expected value of this random variable, and the variance then, of course, being given by sigma square. And of course, we've also seen now a couple of times that this corresponds to this, if you want, structural model. Some people call the structural model that the ith data variable is given by some parameter A plus the product of some parameter B and the value of an independent variable, not a random variable but a variable, plus some error, where this error term is distributed according to a standard normal distribution centered on zero. Oops. And this, of course, not only for single data point but for multiple. So I think if you studied statistics and undergrad statistics, this is most likely what you've seen in undergrad statistics, maybe without the subscript I here, and maybe without this error here. But in general, you should have seen simple linear regression at least in this form here. What we of course studied is that this is equivalent to have the data centered on a plus bx. And you will also, if you have encountered simple linear regression before, you will also have seen or have learned about the nomenclature about these parameters, namely that a is commonly referred to as an offset parameter, and B is referred to as slope. What's going on? And now in its design matrix form, it's essentially just a question of writing this set of equations here in one equation, because these are n equations for n data points, and in design matrix form we just write this in one equation. So we assume our standard GLM form, and then we of course concatenate all data in an n-dimensional vector, and the crucial thing is then the definition of the design matrix, which in simple linear regression has a specific form, namely there's a column of ones, and in the second column you put the values of the independent variable, and correspondingly, so this is then an n times 2 dimensional design matrix, and correspondingly the beta parameter hosts the parameters which are given by A and B. So the first entry of the beta parameter corresponds to the offset parameter, and the second to the slope parameter. If you put in the first column a column of ones, and in the second column the independent variable values. Of course, if you do it reverse in the design matrix, then also your beta parameters are reversed, and you have a two-dimensional parameter vector. So this just simply follows from actually then computing this matrix product, which gives exactly this as the expectation for this multivariate Gaussian. So for each random variable in this random vector y, you get as expectation A plus B X I, which is what you want. So that's the design, that the design matrix and the beta parameter that corresponds to simple linear regression. Then of course the beta parameters can be estimated, and they can be estimated of course according to our standard formula for the beta parameter estimates. And and then of course correspond to the estimated offset and the estimated slope parameter, and based on these estimates we can of course do tests for a non-zero, for example, a non-zero offset or a non-zero slope parameter. If I manage to get that in here, doesn't want to do it. So, and what one can do in simple linear regression is go a little bit more into details of how these beta parameters evaluate in terms of the design matrix. It's a little bit more tedious than in the case of the t-test, where we did that last time and then basically found that we have as beta parameter estimator the sample mean, and as standard as variance parameter we obtain the sample variance. Here, if we only consider the beta parameter vector, what one can show, and you find this in the script on simple linear regression, that the slope parameter is given by the average of the data, so the sample mean of the data, minus the sample mean of the independent variable, and scaled by the ratio of essentially the covariation, so SXY is the sum from I to n, or I should say the simple covariation. Divided by the variance or the sample variance in the independent variable. So that's Sx, which is, oops, this m is wrong. Should be n, of course. And the slope parameter, and that's maybe even more interesting, is given by the unstandardized sample covariance divided by the variance of the independent variable. And why this is interesting is actually because one can, but we will not do that unfortunately because I didn't manage to prepare this fully, then study the detailed connections between simple linear regression and correlation. Because I've seen that in undergrad statistics, this is without many details, just then always said, yeah, and the slope parameter, that's the correlation. And one needs to be a little more careful there. And one way to go about this is to start from these explicit forms for the beta parameter estimates in a simple linear regression design, and then relate them to the formulas of correlation. So that's basically, yeah, I'm just telling you that this can be done in future iterations of me teaching this material. I will make this more explicit. I won't make it more explicit now because I haven't prepared it. But you might remember something like that from undergrad statistics, especially if it's then about z-scored independent and dependent variables, that then this is a correlation or something. And this is essentially where this, from a mathematical perspective, is coming from. The proof for these forms of the beta hat parameters, of course, comes where they're coming from, comes from this form of the design matrix, and then evaluating the inverse of the cross product and so on, and reformulating. But there's, yeah, it's some work to do, and but this is kind of the first step into understanding the relations between regression and correlation. The most important thing always to remember about the difference between regression and correlation is, in regression, the values of x, what we call the independent variable here, are not modeled by a random variable. They are fixed and known. In correlation, you have a bivariate scenario where both your x and your y are random variables. So that's a fundamental difference between correlation and regression. But there are, because correlation measures linear dependencies, there are obvious relationships between simple linear regression and correlation, and they can be spelled out more based on looking actually how the beta parameter estimates look in the simple linear regression case. And this can actually also be more explicit, or can be taken further to the level of multiple linear regression, where you then can look at things like partial correlation. But this, for me, it's fine if you know this and that you have an idea about the beta parameter estimates to study fully the relationship between simple linear regression and correlation. That's at this point beyond the scope of this course. It's not because it's so hard, but it's because it's additional work and takes additional time that I did not commit in this year, and also because we have also other things to still take care of, namely ANOVA designs. If one is visualizing this, and here I applied it to the relationship between DLPFC volume and age. What one typically does is one plots the data points, so the vector y and the associated values of the independent variables, so x1 to xn, which were here the ages, the different ages of the participants, and the DLPFC volume on the y-axis. And then this regression line that you see here is given by the design matrix multiplied by the estimated parameters. So once the parameters are estimated, they of course can be used to make the deterministic prediction of this estimated model, which then is the regression line that is typically overlaid on such plots. And yeah, then we're defining contrast vectors, and of course first evaluating also the variance parameter. One can do tests for non-zero slopes or non-zero offsets. Okay, so that's everything I actually wanted to say to simple linear regression. So basically just pointing you towards the fact that one can establish relationships to correlations here, but not spelling them out in detail. Yeah, but that's it on simple linear regression. Are there any questions on simple linear regression? That does not seem to be the case. So then let's go to multiple linear regression. And multiple linear regression is also something that we've seen before, and in a way it's also the most general way to think about the GLM, because in this scenario the design matrix can actually do whatever it wants. So in multiple linear regression, let's see whether I can scroll now. Still not. Ah, no. We have we just essentially consider the entries of the design matrix. So we index every entry of the design matrix according to its row and column index. So we go from i1 to n, and we have p columns, and each hash has its associated beta value. So our deterministic prediction, our expectation parameter, is given. We can actually make our life very simple and write this as one. No. So that's our expectation. Of course we can spell out that a little bit more, namely that we add all columns of the design matrix in a given row weighted by the beta parameters up to the pth one. And of course we can choose that our first column is a column of ones if we want to model an offset, but we don't have to. That's yeah, can be done, doesn't have to be done. It's a modeling choice. And the errors of course being univariate Gaussians. And in terms of the design matrix, this is then just, of course, a design matrix with axes indexed in terms of their column and row indices. So one example I included in the script is to now analyze the data set of the DLPFC volume, where we have two continuous regressors, namely alcohol and age, and an offset in a simple linear regression design. So that would have or that would be a design matrix with three columns, so to make this explicit, a multiple linear regression design that looks as follows. So we have two regressors, x one and going to x. Oh, sorry, that's the wrong number. Oh, and one going. The second, actually, no, yeah, it really doesn't matter. So I think what is better? No, it's actually better to do it this way than I did it in the script. I think, I did it in the script like this. So the I denotes the row index, so that's the data point, and the J denotes the column index. So yeah, everything is fine. So here we would have 1, 2, V dots and XN 2. So then we have a design matrix with three columns, and we have one offset parameter and two slope parameters. And the question is then a little bit, what is that supposed to mean? So we have a B1 corresponding to the first column of axis here, and a B2 corresponding to the second column of axis. And if we fit something like this, this is what we get. So our first set of axes now encodes the, for example, the H factor, or second column of axes, the alcohol factor, and then this construct here, the product of the design matrix and the beta parameter vector, encodes a plane. So for you can change the x's and you the x1s, so the h, and you can change the alcohol to x2, so you have a function of two parameters that is just linear in each of the parameters. So the x1s are multiplied by v1, the x2s are multiplied by v2, and there's an offset, so it doesn't at b1 and b2 being zero, it's not necessary that the function is also zero. And this encodes a plane in two-dimensional space, and this is what is then shown here. So the data points are plotted as black dots in for each value that we observed, a specific age and a specific alcohol consumption, we plot the DLPFC volume, and then what we also plot is the product of the design matrix, so this design matrix here, and the estimated beta parameters. And then our B1 and B2 are the slopes in the respective dimensions. So you can see that there's a negative slope here with alcohol, so more alcohol, less DLPFC volume. And there's also a negative slope with age, so older, less DLPFC volume. And how this, so it will always be a plane, but how this plane in 2D lies in there, of course, depends on how the data are located and distributed, and then how the beta parameter estimates come about. These kind of visualizations are actually not often seen, and of course it's actually also harder than to visualize a hyperplane. So this is a hyperplane because it's a three-dimensional space, and the plane is two-dimensional. It's harder to visualize a hyperplane in 4D or 5D, so meaning multiple linear regression designs with more than two independent variables. But yeah, it also shows a little bit the complexity in these models that then is that one buys in if one goes into multiple linear regression designs, because it's not that easy anymore to understand what's going on even in a multiple linear regression with only two independent variables. And then again, based on better parameter estimates and contrast vectors, one can do tests, as I will also then explain once we do multiple linear regression and functional neural imaging. Okay, so that's kind of showing you and reminding you of the multiple linear regression design. Are there any questions regarding this right now? Okay, so especially in multiple linear regression designs, the question comes up of how the regressors are actually related. And then it's important that, so intuitively, the important thing here is that your regressors, two regressors, do not take on exactly the same values, so that they are not exactly the same for all data points, because then it's clear that it's not clear in a way how variability in the data should be allocated to either of the regressors. So if your regressors are, what people then always say, fully correlated, then it's not a good design, because there's no principal way of deciding what kind of data variability should be allocated to which regressor. But actually, the more fundamental property that determines how well parameters can be estimated in terms of the covariance and whether they can be estimated at all. So if you have a full, what we will see later on in one way or another, if you have full linear dependency, then you cannot estimate anything anymore. A way to quantify that is the three concepts, namely the linear independency, the orthogonality, and the correlatedness of regressors. And here I just want to give definitions what these terms are, so that there's a little bit less talk about always correlated regressors, because that's correlated regressors are not the principal problem. The principal problem are linear dependent regressors. So this is now just essentially these are just three definitions. So linear dependence. So what we consider here always are two regressors. So two vectors, so x1 and x2, which you should think of columns of the design matrix, and two regressors or two n-dimensional vectors are called linearly independent if and only if there exists no A such that A x1 equals x2, x1 and x2. So that's a fairly fundamental thing, and means that one regressor is not a scalar multiple of the other regressor. So if you have two regressors and you can get x2 by just multiplying x1 by a scalar, for example only by one, so if they are the same, then they are not linearly independent. However, if they are different, so if they have different entries, for at least one entry, then you cannot just multiply one regressor and get the other. So if you think of, for example, of the vectors 1, 2, and 3, and the other one vector is 1, 3, and 3, then you cannot multiply either vector by a number such that it's transformed into the other vector. And then these vectors are not linearly dependent, they are linearly independent. And that's essentially linear independence is what you need for the GLM to be estimable. So for the design matrix to be of a full column rank, which is the assumption that we have all the time for all our GLMs. There are what is not necessary, but what is often desired, is that the regressors are orthogonal. The definition of orthogonal regressors is as follows: x and 1 are called orthogonal if the dot product of x1 and x2 evaluates to 0. And then the two vectors are orthogonal. And if two vectors are orthogonal, they are always linearly independent. But if they are linear independent, they are not necessarily orthogonal. There are three examples in the script, and one of them is the case. The first example is the case of 1, 1, 2, 3, and 2, 3, 4, 5. These are linear independent, but they are clearly not orthogonal. And the second example is a case where the third one is a case where the vectors are orthogonal and linearly independent. Again, for the GLM to work, you need linear independence. Orthogonality is not required per se. It has certain benefits to have orthogonal regressors, but that's also then beyond the scope of today's session. And then there's also the notion of uncorrelatedness. And again, in principle, correlation doesn't really apply in the setting here, because we assume that the independent variables are not random variables, so they don't have a correlation because they are not random variables. But we can, of course, compute their sample correlation. Then we have the following definition, that x1 and x2 are uncorrelated if and only if their centered versions, so the respective vectors minus a vector of 1s times the of 1s times the average of the values is orthogonal to the centered version of the second vector. So correlatedness refers to centered vectors, so vectors from which their average has been subtracted. And these are not one-to-one relationships, so you can have orthogonal vectors that are uncorrelated, but you can also have orthogonal vectors that are not uncorrelated. So it's so for example example 3 shows two vectors, 1 minus 5 3 and minus 5, and 1 5 5 1 x2 5 1 1 3. These vectors are orthogonal, but they are not uncorrelated. In any case, the important thing is always whether two regressors in your design are linearly dependent or not. If they are linear dependent, so you can multiply one vector into the other, then your GLM cannot be estimated, because the design matrix is not of full column rank, and the this matrix here cannot be inverted. If they are values that have some degree of non-orthogonality or uncorrelatedness, they will still not be linear dependent, but have some form of collinearity. And this then affects the covariance of your beta parameter estimates, and hence is something that you want to avoid. By changing the design. And this leads directly to this measure of statistical efficiency. So this thing here on these definitions of vectors, this is mainly there to get the language clear and not always talk about correlated regressors when you actually mean linearly dependent. Oops, is that a bit too small? Linear dependent regressors. In fMRI designs, or in general multiple linear regression designs, the question is then still, if there is some degree of collinearity between my vectors, so they are not linearly dependent but they are also not orthogonal, is this still a good design? And this can be answered in many ways, because there may be many things that determine what a good design is. But one way that has been proposed in the fMRI world is the following measure of design efficiency. So this is a design efficiency criterion. I call this C, and it takes a contrast vector, because it depends on which contrast you're actually looking at, and it takes a design matrix, because you want to change the design matrix to make it better, and it actually maps onto only the positive numbers. So for each contrast and design matrix, what you're looking here at is the following number: the contrast vector times the inverse of this and the inverse of the whole thing. So that's a criterion for design efficiency. So that's a function of the design matrix, so of things like the orthogonality or the uncorrelatedness of your regressors, and gives you back a number which, if it gets large, tells you that this is a good design. If it gets small, it's a bad design. The question is, what does it mean, and why this formula? And there, as a reminder, covariance of the beta parameter estimate. So the variability of the beta estimates, the variability of your estimates, is given by the true but unknown error, which you cannot influence if you're optimizing your design. So because when you optimize your design, you only change your design matrix. And this product here. So exactly this thing here. Let's make this yellow and this yellow. So this and specific, for example, the diagonal elements of this thing here encode the variability, so the variance of your beta parameter estimates. And of course you want beta parameter estimates that vary as little as possible as determined by the overall error variance. Now this criterion is the inverse of this. So if you have higher variance, then you get less efficiency, or if you have lower variance here, then you get a higher efficiency. And this criterion selects a specific part or linear combination of the entries in the covariance matrix of your beta parameter, that beta parameter estimate. So for example, if you use a contrast vector corresponding to a 1 and 0, 0, 0s for all other entries, then you're looking at the variance of a given beta parameter. If you use a contrast vector, for example, if you have two beta parameter values and you use a contrast vector 1 minus 1, then you look at the efficiency of evaluating a contrast, so the difference between two beta parameters. And this then can be used as a function that you want to optimize in terms of changing your design matrix with the aim of minimizing the variance of your beta parameter estimates at a given variance level, at a given error variance. Yeah. So again, the idea is there is some variability variance in the data that comes from the errors. You can induce more or less variability in your estimators by choosing a specific design matrix. Now you want to change your design matrix in principle that minimizes the variability of your estimates for a fixed error variability. And of course, this is just one criterion. Yeah. So you can say, okay, I want to minimize the variability of my beta parameter estimates at a fixed value of the error noise of the error variance. But of course, you might also, from an fMRI design, for example, you might think that you don't want to present the same condition over and over again, because then it gets boring for the participant or something like this. This is then an additional criterion for design optimization that is not captured by this design efficiency measure. But so this is a purely statistical design efficiency measure. And if you now open the literature on optimizing fMRI designs, this is one criterion you find there. But of course, you can also create other loss functions that include other aspects, and that then can also be addressed. Yeah. Good. So I think this is actually what the few highlights that I wanted to give you about multiple linear regression in the general setting, because of course this design efficiency measure applies not only to fMRI but to any kind of multiple linear regression and design. But of course it applies in fMRI in specifically. Actually, I have a simulation of this for actually deciding how to separate events in time. Later on, when we talk about multiple linear regression for fMRI, are there any questions right now regarding the latter two points here?
Dirk, for your definition of uncorrelated, you said that the centered versions of the vectors are orthogonal. So should that product be okay? There we go.
Thank you.
We'll see.
And again, so these definitions here are mainly there so that We don't do much with them. It's more that I want here, of course, this can be developed further. Of course, one can then study how uncorrelatedness or correlatedness affects design efficiency measures and so on. So the only thing that I'm trying to establish here is the right terminology, and that if you read then papers that say we orthogonalized our regressors or we use uncorrelated regressors, you know what they mean. So that's the point. It's not so much that we can really do much with that based on these definitions. Anything else?
What would I mean if the dot product between x1 and x2 is bigger than zero?
That would mean that they are not orthogonal. And orthogonal you can intuitively understand as being at a 90 degree angle. Of course, that works well for two-dimensional vectors. If you go to higher dimensions, that's not quite clear. So if it's if the dot product is not zero, one can translate this to the angle, so based on the cosine function, and it just then means an angle that is smaller than 90 degrees. Anything else? Okay, so after this kind of quick reminder of multiple linear regression, in the next hour I then want to tell you how multiple linear regression is used in the analysis of fMRI data, so that you have a rough understanding of how the GLM in its multiple linear regression form is actually applied in fMRI data analysis. But let's have a break now and start again at 10:35. I need a little bit of a break. So 10:35, not 35, it's almost 25, right? So let's start again at 10:40. Okay, so then in this last part, I would like to give you a visual intuition of what all of this that we discussed in this course on the GLM actually has to do with what you came for to scan, namely to learn about function neuroimaging, if you came to scan for learning about function neuroimaging, specifically fMRI. And as I mentioned previously, first level fMRI data analysis, so the analysis of a single participant fMRI data set in a task scenario. So if you're not studying resting state, although then you can also use GLMs, but if you're using task data, it's even more common, is typically done using multiple linear regression designs formulated as GLMs. So in fMRI, one always talks about a GLM analysis of fMRI data, for example, first level fMRI data. One doesn't say a multiple linear regression analysis of fMRI data, although it's in fact a multiple linear regression analysis, so a specific form of GLM analysis. And to understand how this is basically working and what the ideas there are, I have this kind of visual example that I will now present. Of course, the whole thing starts from the data, and in the script you find again some description of fMRI data acquisition and fMRI data pre-processing, as we also discuss, of course, in neurocognitive methods. What we require for the GLM analysis of fMRI data or multiple linear regression of fMRI data, so participant based fMRI data analysis, is a data set that is of the form that you see in this table. So we have two dimensions here, one being space indexed by voxel, so 3D locations in the brain, which I here now not order according to their 3D location, but just label from 1 to N, maybe starting in the upper right corner, I don't know, and then going in a specific way through all voxels and ending up in the lower left corner of the brain, something like that, or of the image. So we have the space domain with voxels, and we have the time domain with time points or images. So remember that the MRI scanner, each TR, and by now you should know what TR means, each TR takes a full 3D picture of the brain that comprises all M voxels, and this EPI image is acquired at a specific time after the onset of the run, which is typically also the onset of the experiment, and hence reflects the value of the MRI signal. Oops, what happened now? The value of the MRI signal. There it is again. The value of the MRI signal at a given point in time. So we have. If you want a 4D image set, so we have 3D space here now as the column axis, and we have time here, the different EPI images in the row axis. For each voxel, that means that we have as many values as there are images being acquired, and I call this number n. And they form a time series, so they have a specific order, but there are n of them. So for example, if we acquire 400 images during an MRI run, then for each voxel we have 400 values, so a 400 dimensional vector, and each column here could be then a 400 dimensional vector. Now, the first thing to realize in fMRI data analysis is that the data that is being analyzed with a specific design matrix, so the Y in our GLM that we've been discussing all the time, corresponds to corresponds to one of these columns here, yeah. So for one voxel, we have an n-dimensional vector of data. And this is what we're trying to describe with the GLM. Of course, we don't only have one voxel, but we have multiple voxels. However, and we analyze the data from all of these voxels, but we always use the same GLM. So our data in the GLM is the data from one voxel, and we apply the GLM with the same design matrix to each and every voxel. The data that we are analyzing is hence univariate in the sense that for each time point or for each measurement point, we have a scalar, yeah. So the MR signal of each voxel, and then they are concatenated, and not multivariate. So we don't have two values per measurement point or or m values per measurement point, but only one. But we do this over and over again. So this is what the people then call a mass univariate approach. Of course, we can also use multivariate approaches to an fMRI data analysis, and there are many of them. The most basic maybe being the multivariate GLM. So we could also model the entire data set using a multivariate GLM, where our y is not n-dimensional, but an n times m matrix. But this is not what we are doing. We didn't discuss multivariate GLMs, we discuss GLMs, and there the data is univariate, and this is also how the data is commonly analyzed. Now, historically, of course, what's been happening is that people presented, for example, two conditions, and then for a given voxel, they looked at the values they got from condition one and from condition two, and then they did a t-test to compare or to evaluate the null hypothesis that the expectations for the values that they get under each conditions are identical. So they did fairly simple GLM designs on the data of a given voxel. And this has then in the 90s been refined and made more beautiful, essentially, by incorporating this inner multiple linear regression GLM. But the first thing that we now that is important to realize is that if we look at the GLM equation in its basic form, namely this, the y here in fMRI is the data of a single voxel, the time series of a single voxel. And the other thing is to realize that if we then specify a design matrix and the associated beta parameters, we apply this design matrix and estimate beta parameters for each and every voxel. So for each and every voxel, we get beta parameter estimates, and we assume that there are true but unknown beta parameter estimates. And we also assume that there are, for each voxel, individual variance parameters. But the design matrix remains the same over voxels, which is also a fairly strong assumption, because the design matrix of course reflects how or models, as we will see in a second, how external stimuli are then evoke activity in the brain. And of course certain parts of the brain, for certain parts in the brain this is sensible, for example primary visual cortex, of course directly activated or more or less directly activated by visual input, but higher order association cortices, frontal cortex and so on definitely get their signal not directly from the outside world but from other brain areas. So it actually, it's a little bit questionable whether it's sensible to view the frontal cortex also being directly influenced by external stimuli and not by also the activity that is happening inside the brain. And this is then where dynamic causal models, so differential equation models that explicitly model biological phenomena and biophysical dynamics come in. But that's beyond the scope. So important is to realize that the design matrix that is used here is the same for each and every voxel. Now, to understand these design matrices and the logic behind all of this, we look at an example here. But first, are there any questions regarding the organization of fMRI data and the principal application of the GLM in this form? Because that's really crucial. There is also the slide in neurocognitive methods where I show the brain and then I show these time series. This is exactly the same thing, it just looks a little bit different. Okay, apparently not. Then, to understand what's now happening, there are two things that are important. So the first thing to realize is that while MRI data is recorded, so while the participant is in the scanner and this four-dimensional data set is acquired, typically task conditions are performed. If you're not doing resting state like 70% of the people right now, because they can't be bothered to do anything interesting anymore, they just put the subject into the scanner, let's do something with the data, I don't care, so they gave up on everything. If you use experiments where people actively engage in a task, you would, in the most basic scenario, would have for example two different conditions. And what is shown here for 250 seconds are the occurrences of stimuli conforming to condition 1 and condition 2. And you condition 1 here is blue, so you have here at 0 you have condition 1 occurs, then at 20 seconds condition 1 occurs, at 30 seconds condition 2 occurs, then condition 1 occurs again, and then condition 2 occurs a couple of times. And condition 1 and condition 2 could for example be faces and houses being presented, or people attending to motion and attending to color respectively in these two conditions. So it can be external stimuli, it can be internal stimuli, whatever. It's two different conditions in a design. It's of course the most basic design where you have just two conditions. Now what you in in addition, also need to appreciate is that the basic idea is that in response to some form of internal or external stimulation that happens at a given time point, the Bolt signal rises and decays according to a specific functional form, which you have already seen in neurocognitive methods, namely the hemodynamic response function, which goes up with a certain delay after the experimental condition and its associated neural activity. So the idea is here that if the condition occurs, then at least with respect to the time resolution of fMRI, at the same time activity, neural activity happens in the brain. And with some delay, typically 5 to 6 seconds to peak, the hemodynamic response is going up. Now these are two experimental conditions. So subject is in the scanner. Twice the first condition is presented, then at the next time point the second condition, and then again condition one. So that's what's happening. And the idea is that to each of these condition presentations, the brain responds, if it responds, and if it's responsive to this condition, with a hemodynamic response function. Now, for the sake of the example, there are two voxel responses, which you maybe we have to do it like this anyway, which you should view with respect to the conditions. So you need to look at the conditions here and look at the time series. So we have voxel A and voxel B, two different voxels, and we have two different conditions. Now the thing that you're supposed to see here is, instead of doing this interactively, I just explain it. This voxel A here has peaks, and sometimes it doesn't have peaks. If you look at when it has a peak, so when the MR signal at that voxel, so that brain location, goes up, and you compare it with the time course of condition 1 and condition 2, you see that it has peaks whenever, or roughly whenever condition 1 came up. So for example, it has a peak 5 seconds after condition 1 comes on here at 0, it's a little bit hard to see. Then it has a peak at when condition 1 comes up a little bit later, here there's a peak, then it takes a little bit of a break where condition 2 is happening, then it has a peak again when condition 1 is happening, and then there is a long break when these three stimuli from condition 1 are coming. So by looking at the voxel time series of this voxel A, we would say, okay, this voxel responds to condition 1, it does not respond to condition 2, because it always shows signal rises, or the signal rises if condition 1 is presented. Now if we look at voxel B, we see that it basically always has peaks whenever any of the conditions is presented. So whenever something is happening, so think of this red thing being inside here and also here, then voxel B is always responding. So from looking at the time course of voxel B, we would say, okay, it's responsive to the two conditions, but it does not differentiate between the conditions. So a very basic interpretation without doing any analysis, if these are visual stimuli and one of them is faces, so let's say condition one is faces and the other is houses, this voxel A would respond only if a face is presented, but not if some kind of visual stimulus is presented, and voxel B would respond to faces and houses, or maybe more generally to any kind of visual stimulation. So now how can this be quantified, and how does this then relate to the multiple linear regression approach? There you first need to think about what how these kind of data can be modeled, and this is what is shown here in terms of the predicted MR signal. So based on the idea that if there is a response in the brain, so neural response to some external condition. The brain answers in the fMRI signal with this hemodynamic response function. Then for condition one, you would predict this kind of time series. For condition two, you would predict this form of time series. So what's happening here is you have these stick functions, which just reflect when a certain condition is presented. And this is, of course, not what you expect the brain to do, but what you expect the brain in terms of the MR signal to do is to rise and decay according to the hemodynamic response function. So in essence, you replace each of these onsets of a condition, which is here just reflected by the stick function, with a hemodynamic response function at the given time. So again, here at zero, there is an onset of condition one, and the corresponding peak in the hemodynamic response function, in the hemodynamic response to condition one, is then 5 seconds later. So you can view this as just replacing the stick functions here with hemodynamic responses, and taking care of overlaps. What's actually behind this is convolution. So you convolve the onset functions with the hemodynamic response function, so to basically build in the linear time invariant system properties of the Bolt signal that are assumed and partially experimentally justified. But we are not discussing convolution in this iteration of the course, so you can just think in terms of these stick functions are replaced by the hemodynamic response functions, and if there is some overlap, which is here is not, then this is probably taken care of so that you have summation in the signal here. Now this is again happening at the level of the model, and now the design matrix and multiple linear regression view comes in if you view condition one and condition two as regressors in your design matrix. And this is then what's shown here. So this is now a design matrix with two predictors, so no offset, and the first column corresponds to the values that are in the predicted MR signal for condition one, and the values in the second column conform to the predicted MR signal for condition two. So for example, here at the beginning you have these two peaks, so light means higher value. You have these two peaks which correspond to these two condition one onsets, and then as the third event you have a peak here for condition two. Now how can we then represent these kind of voxel time courses in terms of the GLM? We already established that voxel A looks as if it only responds to condition one, but not to condition two. In terms of a matrix product in this form, this of course corresponds to the fact that the true but unknown beta parameter is one for this first regressor, for the blue regressor, which is here in the first column, and zero for the second regressor or predictor. So zero for condition two. So if we multiply this design matrix, so where this is the first column and this is the second column, with a beta parameter of one and zero, then we get something roughly like this. Of course, what we also assume in the GLM is some non-systematic zero-centered Gaussian noise, which is shown here, and which then, if you add the two together, so the design matrix times the beta parameter vector plus this noise vector, you get this observed time series here. Now for... Nee, ich will keine Form eingeben. Oops. Now for the second voxel, if we think in terms of this design matrix, which as a first column predictor has this predicted MR signal, and as a second column, like here, has, because we're applying the same design matrix to all voxels, has the condition 2 predicted MR signal. If we want to reproduce that if we want to reduce the time series like this, then we would set the two beta parameters to the same value, so that if we do this matrix product, we would get basically pick up whenever something is happening in the first column here or in the second column. And then if we add some noise, then we observe a time series like this. Now this is an example, this is kind of a generative view on this. Of course, we are not given the two but unknown beta parameter values, but from what we everything that we learned, we of course know now that the GLM works, and if the noise is not too large, it can actually estimate the two but unknown parameter values well. So if we actually evaluate the beta parameter estimates for voxel A, we will get beta parameter estimates that are roughly 1 and roughly 0. So they're examples of that, how they actually are in the script. Here below, I actually for voxel A, I plot the time series of voxel A, and on top the design matrix product of the design matrix with the estimated parameters. So that if you want the simple linear regression line here in or in this case multiple linear regression line for for a single voxel. The same thing in voxel B, based on estimates that would come out roughly 1 and 1 for this kind of time series. Yeah. So the important thing here to note, and this is why I'm doing this, is that the responsiveness of a voxel to a given condition is encoded in the pattern of the beta parameters. Yeah, so voxel 1 responds only to condition 1, not to condition 2. This corresponds to a beta parameter value of large or 1 to the first condition, and close to 0 for the second condition. Voxel 2 responds to both conditions, and this corresponds to roughly similar beta parameters. Now in fMRI, this would be then the beta parameter vectors for each voxel. And if you do, for example, this analysis with SPM, you would start with your data, you specify your design matrix, which is the same for all voxels, and then you get an image for each entry in your beta parameter vector. So you get for each voxel of course has a beta 1, and if you concatenate all these beta 1s together, you have again a 3D image that holds all the beta 1 values, and you can in this case have a 3D image that holds all the beta 2 values. Now what is then of most interest to most people is whether a given voxel responds more to a given condition than to a different condition. And this is then where the notion of contrast vectors again comes in, because one wants to know whether a given voxel responds differentially to, why does everything always disappear? A given voxel responds differentially to different conditions. And this is then mapped onto contrast vectors that assess the differences between beta parameter vectors. So one way to specify contrast vectors here is to specify contrast vectors that test for the effect of a given condition. So to assess whether beta 1 or beta 2 are different from 0. By means of the t-statistic that we discussed in previous lectures. By setting contrast vectors of the form 1, 0, then you get beta 1, or 0, 1, then you get beta 2, and there you would find, for example, for this contrast vector that voxel 1, so if you use this contrast vector and multiply it with your estimate here, so 1 and roughly 0, or roughly 1 and roughly 0, then you would get 0, and then you would not find a high t-statistic to reject the null hypothesis, meaning that obviously voxel A did not respond to condition 2. That's one thing. The other thing is in terms of different responses. And for example, if you want to evaluate the null hypothesis that the response to the first condition is larger than the second condition, this of course corresponds to the fact that one that beta 1 minus beta 2 is larger than 0, because then beta 1 is larger than beta 2. A contrast vector like this would be used. So here you would then multiply your beta estimate with this contrast vector and find that, for example, for voxel B, this contrast of the beta parameter estimates evaluates roughly to 0. You would likely not reject the null hypothesis, which has to do with the fact that this voxel does not differentiate between condition. For voxel A, however, the response to condition 1 is much larger than to condition 2. So here you would, if you use this contrast vector, you would get a value that is quite different from 0, so a high t value, which you might then, which might be that high that you reject the null hypothesis. In any case, the t values that you get from these kind of contrasts on the beta parameter estimates are what are then visualized in the statistical parametric maps. So these are t values. Here for, let's say, this contrast 1 minus 1, meaning that there was a response to condition 1 but not to condition 2. And all other voxels that are masked out here either did not respond at all or responded the same to both conditions. And this is then these kind of T-maps, which you then can threshold according to the theory of random fields, which you can read all about in my papers on this topic. But these T-maps are then essentially the end result of an fMRI multiple linear regression analysis. Yeah, I think that's in essence how multiple linear regression and the logic of multiple linear regression is used in fMRI. Questions regarding this? No questions. Was very clear. Good, I'm fine with that. So if there are no questions, let's stop that for today here. If questions come up regarding the GLM course, today's session or any sessions before, feel free to ask them in the Q&A session at 4. And otherwise, we meet at 3 p.m. again, first to hear something about non-Bold fMRI and then to hear something about negative Bold in fMRI. Okay, then have a nice lunch break and see you later. Bye-bye.